Who is this man that even the power of death can't break? Angels and demons alike answer to his name. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Yeah. increase our faith today. A deeper revelation of who you are, Jesus. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Living Word, Bread of Life, Holy One, you are. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Living Word, the Bread of Life, Holy One. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Living Word, Bread of Life, Holy One. We declare it. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Living Word. Jesus, the Holy One, the righteous Son of God. Oh, we lift you up, we lift you up, we lift you up. Oh, we lift you up. Oh,
all Jesus, we honor you. The lamb that was slain. You shed your blood for the forgiveness of sins. And you overcame. You're the lion of the tribe of Judah who has conquered and overcome. Father, I thank you that you've installed your King Jesus on Zion, your holy hill. Jesus, you're the name that's above every name. Revelation 15, great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God, the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed. Lord God Almighty, just and true are your judgments. The nations conspire against you to throw off your bonds, but you have installed your King on your holy hill. And he is the name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is God, to the glory of God our Father. So we proclaim your name, Jesus, over sickness. We proclaim your name, Jesus, over demonic ideology. We proclaim your name, Jesus, over this city. We proclaim your name, Jesus, over this nation and the nations of the world. Lord, even as Hamas has released three sets of hostages this last 24 hours, God, we proclaim your name over Palestine, over Gaza, and over Israel. And we declare, God, that you move powerfully. And we're asking you, King of the nations, to release all of the hostages that are remaining. And Lord, we're asking you, King of the nations, to destroy the work of the evil one. You've already destroyed the work. Lord, let us see it come into fruition, Lord, and that the power of Satan in Gaza and in the West Bank will be destroyed. Even the power of Satan within Israel be destroyed in Jesus' name. Kingdom of God come. We give you glory, Jesus. We give you glory. Lord, we proclaim your name over relational breakdowns in our families. We proclaim your name over prodigals, people that have walked away from you. Proclaim your name over those that have not yet said yes to you. We proclaim your love, your glory, your goodness, your kindness, your faithfulness, your gentleness, your humility, your glory and your just judgment. Kingdom of God come. a song arise. Sing to the Lord a new song. A song of worship. A song of adoration. A song of praise. A song of declaration. We're declaring the name of Jesus to our city, to our neighborhoods, to our workplaces, to our families, to our world. We're proclaiming that the earth belongs to the Lord. The whole earth and all the peoples belong to Jesus because He's won them. He's purchased men and women from every tribe and tongue and nation. So we lift up your name, Jesus. And power, dominion and might, worship and thanksgiving, riches, it all belongs to you, Jesus, glorious King. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Your dominion will have no end. We pledge again our allegiance to you, Jesus. We pledge our allegiance to you. You're the one that we want. You're the one that we need. You're the one that we desire. Good is Jesus. He's the Father's best gift to you and I. He's come from a heart of love, from a Father who loves us so deeply and so dearly that He desired for each one of us to have a way to come back to Him and to experience the love and the life and the joy that we were created for in the first place. He loves us so deeply that He sent His Son to undo us from the work of the enemy, that everything that's wrong with the world to be reconciled and to be healed and to be transformed by the power of the blood of Jesus. That means it's not just that we have salvation and that one day when we die, we're going to go to heaven. It means that everything that was wrong with earth is now going to be, is being righted by the blood of Jesus. And that heaven and earth, which were once disconnected because of sin, have now been reconnected because of the blood of Jesus, and we stand in His love and in His glory. It's the good news. And the truth is, for each one of us, for all of humanity, is Jesus is the just judge of all the earth. And there is a day that's coming where He will judge the living and the dead, is what the Bible says. and he will judge with justice. In other words, he will see every wrongdoing and he will judge every wrongdoing and he will punish everything that has been, every place where people have hurt you, offended you, done terrible things to you. God will bring justice. And that's good news because it means he's love. The problem that we have is that we ourselves need justice because we've hurt other people and we've fallen short of God's purposes and God's grace. So we can't have justice for others but not receive justice ourselves. And the beautiful good news of Jesus is that he has, as he's taken the payment and the punishment for all the things that you and I have done wrong, all the guilt and all the shame, and he's paid it upon Jesus, and Jesus has received the punishment so that God in his justice could let you and I go free when we say yes to Jesus. What manner of love is this? And so there will be a day when each one of us will bow the knee and our tongues will confess that Jesus is God. The question is, will it be this side of when we die, when we have a choice to do that, or when we pass into that place after death and we have no choice because we see God in his glory, but it's too late to do anything about it? And I want to give an invitation to all of anybody that's here that has not yet said yes to Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Every single one of us here that doesn't know the love of the Father, I want to give you an invitation to receive that love and to walk free into the goodness and the grace of Jesus. And it's very simple. We just pray this very simple prayer. And I want to invite you to stand if you would, please. And we'll just pray this prayer together. And this prayer is, Jesus, I need you. I recognize that there's issues in my life. I've hurt other people. I've hurt myself. I've ignored you. And I recognize that there's a day of judgment coming. And I ask you that you would save me from that judgment and that you would make me your own, that you would fill me with your spirit, that you would cleanse me from the wickedness on the inside and make me your own. I surrender my life to you, Jesus. Would you be my Savior and would you be my Lord? And we believe if you prayed that prayer for the first time, a wonderful and glorious transaction has happened in the spirit realm where you have now come out of darkness and come into the light of God. And you've come out of the power of Satan and you come into the power of God's love. And it's a beautiful and it's a glorious thing. And we want to say to you, welcome home to the Father. And if you prayed that prayer for the first time, or maybe you prayed that prayer a while ago, but then you've been walking away from the Lord, I want to encourage you to do a very brave thing, and that's just wave at me. We had a few people in the first service who responded to this good news. If that's you and you've just prayed that prayer for the first time, wave, just wave at me and say, yeah, I gave my life to Jesus. It's wonderful, wonderful. Thank you, Jesus. This is God. The fact that you're here and that you've responded is proof that God is on your case. He loves you. He's for you. He has a life that you could never, ever experience of joy and peace. You could never experience that on your own. And I want to encourage you one more thing to do, a very brave thing, and that is to come to the front. We've got a team here who would love just to pray with you, to welcome you, to encourage you. You've begun a journey of a relationship. You haven't joined a religion. You've actually come into a relationship with a Father who's always loved you. And I want to encourage you to come up here. We would love to pray for you. We're not going to do anything weird. We're just going to pray for you. We're going to welcome you. We're going to encourage you on what it means to walk with Jesus into this life, in this life. So if that was you, I saw a couple of hands. I want you to be brave, and I want to invite you to come up here to our team, and we will celebrate with you. If you're a bit shy of coming up on your own, feel free to invite someone that came with you or just someone that's next to you and just say, hey, would you come with me, please? Many, many, many of us in this room have done that. We've made a public declaration of our desire and commitment to following Jesus. Come on. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. It's glorious, Jesus. Isn't God good? If there's anyone else, I saw a couple more hands. If there's anyone else that wants to come forward, please come on forward. Yay, Jesus. Oh, he's so good. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You know, just even for one person, it's worth it, right? Wonderful. So I want to encourage you to say hi to somebody. Welcome. It's good to have you here. Just introduce yourself. Thank you, worship team. It's so good to be here. It's good to be together. My name is Murray. If we haven't met before, we're glad that you're here. I want to give you a special warm welcome, particularly if you're a first-time guest with us. It is wonderful to have you here. Now this afternoon, we're about to have Lillian come and preach, but before we do that, a couple of things I want to share with you. One is that we have our Next Steps class that's happening in that room over there to my right, your left. Zach is waving right now. What's our Next Steps class? Well, our Next Steps class is for those of us here that are maybe new to the church and you're not sure what we're about, why we're here, what we're doing. This class is for you. Zach is waving there. Maybe you're here, you've been coming for a while, but you haven't been able to get plugged into a connect group midweek, or you're wanting to learn how to join a team and serve. Well, the Next Steps class is for you. Zach's waving right there. You can, it's going to run now through to preach, and you can watch the preach online if you want to. So Next Steps class, if you're interested, if you're a newcomer, or you want to know some, find more information, you want to help, you know, get plugged in. Well, Zach is waving at you, and we've got a team there. It's going to share a little bit about the church and get to meet some of us pastors, and I'll be there shortly as well. Okay, wonderful. We have March 8th to March the 15th, next 2024. Can you believe it? That's like a month and a half away is 2024. That's crazy. We are having a missions trip to the Dominican Republic. Wonderful. And so you are welcome to sign up. There's information on that QR code. And it's actually during spring break, so it's a wonderful opportunity for families to go and experience God together and change people's lives. We built a house this last year, and it transformed a family's life in Dominican. We're partnering with Shine the Light. A wonderful ministry that's also part of Catch the Fire. Okay, so part of what we love to do is, we've been singing in worship, but we believe that actually worship is more than just singing. It's our whole lives, and part of our act of worship is to return our tithes and sow an offering. And what does that mean? Well, for Ash and I, and for many of us, we've discovered the joy of the reality that everything that we have is God's. And so it's our joy to discover that we can return to him 10% of what he's given us through our salaries and our gifts and the things that God has given us. And we return that as an act of worship to the Lord. And God proves faithful and supplies all of our needs. We also have learned that we can give an offering, we can sow an offering and sow a seed that God will return to us with a harvest. And so that's part of our act of worship. So up on the screen, there's ways that you can give. And if you need any further information, there's a Connect Welcome Center in the glass doors. There's also a giving booth if you need any help. And I'll share a little bit more about that at the end. But we would love to connect with you after the service. And if you have any questions, that's the place to go. But in the meantime, before that point, we've got Lillian. Lillian's one of our pastors, director of supernatural ministry here. She's going to be sharing a part of our foundations series and has a great and wonderful message for all of us. So go for it, Lillian. Bless you.
Thank you so much, Murray. Okay, let's pray. Is that a good thing? Okay. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come before you, thanking you, God, that hearing from you is a benefit of the kingdom of God. We thank you, Father, as part of our inheritance. And Father God, when you speak to us, Lord, that our ears attuned to you, and God, we ask today that you would come, you would pour oil into our ears, that the word that you want to speak to us, God, and what you want to minister to us today, we will hear it with clarity, Father, without any confusion, without any interference, in the name of Jesus. Father, we take authority this morning in the name of Jesus. We bind every interfering spirit. We take authority over every resisting spirit, and we say we are under the blood. We are under the blood of Jesus Christ, and therefore, as your children, O Lord God, we are shielded, protected, and God, that we can hear what you're going to speak to us today in Jesus Christ's name. Amen, amen, amen. Well, we're talking today about hearing God. This is one of our foundation's teachings, and I was reflecting on how great it is to have kids and grandkids. Anybody here have kids and grandkids? It's such an honor, isn't it, to have kids and grandkids. The thing about when you have grandkids is that sometimes you don't pay as much attention to your children. The grandkids get all the attention. So ever so often, my daughter would call me and we would have a conversation on the phone. And while we're talking, believe it or not, almost instinctively all the time, one of her kids suddenly has the most gorgeous picture she just drew, and her mom has to see it right in that moment. Or all of a sudden, they need a snack. My goodness, kids can snack. Or they need to tell their mom something really, really important. And you know, this is sometimes funny, and we have a good laugh about it. But the reality is that everywhere around us, even in the best of circumstances, there are voices competing for our ears. So everywhere we turn, everywhere we look, somebody wants our attention. And in the world that we live in today, we are constantly being baited by information and voices that are trolling around. They want our ears. And we have disinformation, we have misinformation, and disinformation brings us discord, disunity, discouragement, and that's the enemy's way of competing for our ears. And it's not just about our ears, because our ears are the gateway to our hearts, and he wants to get to our hearts. What is the enemy trying to do? He is trying to get after the worship to God. If he could get our attention, and we place our attention on him, and we give him what is due to God, he is trying to get what is rightfully God's, and he's trying to draw us away. Well, the good news is that Jesus came. And in a world today where we're grappling to find truth because we're listening to everything that's coming against us or coming towards us, and we're trying to find truth, Jesus came into the world. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And Jesus came to bring us truth. One of the ways that he gives us truth is by speaking to us. And he is not invasive. He will stand and knock, but he's not invasive. He wants to woo us. He wants to draw us, and he does it so in a lovingly way. We at Catch the Fire explicitly, implicitly believe that we hear from God, and it's one of our foundations. So, how do we hear from Jesus? Well, he made a way for us. When Jesus came to the earth and he left, he said, "It is better that I go." Why? Because the Holy Spirit of God was going to come to the earth. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, we would be able to hear him. The problem with us is sometimes, number one, we don't think we can hear God, we don't believe it, or we have not accessed the way to find Jesus and to hear what God wants to say to us. God has been speaking since the beginning of time. In the Garden of Eden, God was speaking. He spoke throughout the Old Testament, through directly to people, and he spoke through the prophets. And God is still speaking today, and he has so much to say to us. God is never tired. He's always awake 24/7 and he's omnipresent and he wants to tell us great and awesome things. What does he want to tell us? He wants to tell us about ourselves. He wants to empower us by telling us how wonderful we are, how beautiful we are to him, how precious we are. He wants to tell us, he wants to speak into our identity. He wants to tell us great and awesome things that are about to come. He wants to show us his love and his kindness and his goodness. And in speaking to us and us positioning ourselves to hear him, we come into that place of knowing who we are in God. And so, every morning when I wake up, I hear from God. How do I hear from God? One of the first ways I hear from God is the very fact that my eyes open in the morning. Thank you, Jesus. My eyes are open, and when my eyes are open and I look around me, look at all the beauty that God has surrounded me with. Look at all the blessings that I have. I hear from him when I see the sunrise. I hear from him when I see the sunset. When I hear, when I see the beautiful sunshine. Except these days we have more clouds than sunshine, but on the days when there's sunshine. There was a time, however, when God did not speak. Between the Old Testament and the New Testament, there are 400 years where God did not say a thing. If you are attuned to hearing from his voice, think about how that would feel, that you could not hear from God for 400 years. We call these the silent years. And then suddenly, we've got the Old Testament, and right off in the Gospels, God is speaking everywhere. Angels on the earth speaking to people. And Jesus is born. And Jesus in the book of John starts to talk to us about his Father. And he says, I only do what I see and hear my Father doing. Jesus is attuned to his Father's ears. And if we are heir and joint heir with Jesus Christ, we have that same benefit and that same inheritance so that we can hear from God. One of our signature scriptures for hearing from God comes from, okay, that's what you don't do with your Bible. One of our signature scriptures comes from the book of John. So if you want to turn with me to the book of John in chapter 10, and Jesus is saying, very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. Listening is active. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought them all out on his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, and we need to pay attention. When Jesus speaks twice, when something is repeated, we need to listen. Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come and go and find pasture. And then in verse 11, he says, I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And he repeats himself in verse 14, and he says, I'm the good shepherd, I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. So, what is Jesus actually saying? In Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20, Jesus speaking to the churches is speaking to the church of Laodicea, and he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice, I will come in and sup with him. What does that mean? Jesus is always wanting us to hear his voice. He's saying, I'm standing here knocking. And if we put ourselves in that picture, Jesus outside the door, would you not open the door for him? Come on. Jesus is knocking. He says, knock, knock, knock. Hello, can I come in? I want to come and sit with you and sup with you. Sup is not just about eating. It's about spending time in an intimate presence. It's looking each other in the eye and getting to know one another. And Jesus is calling us and saying, I want you to hear my voice, and I want to come in and spend time with you. There is joy in knowing when you're hearing God's voice. It brings this intense feeling inside of you. My goodness, I'm hearing the sound of my beloved. I'm hearing the sound of Jesus. I hear his voice. I want more. And we need to have more. We need to have more of hearing his voice. So when we look at this scripture, keep in mind when Jesus is talking about shepherds, the Pharisees are thinking about, in those days, people that were in places of power and authority, like leaders, politicians, even religious leaders, they were called shepherds. So they understood when Jesus was talking about shepherd. But if somebody's hearing about hearing a shepherd's voice, but that shepherd hasn't been kind or good to them, why would you want to hear that shepherd's voice? That's a conundrum, isn't it? So Jesus specifies and he says, I'm a good shepherd. I am the good shepherd. And when they hear good shepherd, they still don't get it because in their minds they're thinking, well, in Ezekiel 34:23, God says, I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them. He will tend them and be their shepherd. And they're thinking, well, what is he talking about? And David also, in Psalm 23, writes, the Lord is my shepherd. What does he write about? God is a shepherd, his protector, his provider. There is no way that they see anything about hearing God's voice or hearing the voice of the shepherd. Not to mention, for the Pharisees, this is an insulting reference to be called a sheep. They were not his sheep, but the sheep that Jesus is talking about, the people that were following them, following him, this is insulting. Why? Because I don't know if you know this, but sheep are not known to be the most smart, the smartest animal in the farm. It's a fact. People say that, right? What were sheep used for in those days? Well, they were there for meat, wool, right? And sacrificial lamb. They bore the sacrificial lamb for the sacrifices. So they're having quite a confusion over this because they don't understand what Jesus is saying. And then he repeats himself and he says, I tell you, I'm the gate for the sheep. The gate, another word for gate is door. And can I say to you, Jesus is saying, unless you go through me, this door, you're not going to get to the good shepherd, and you won't be able to hear my voice, and I won't know you, and you won't know me. You see, because when Jesus is the door, and the door also to the spirit realm. The spirit realm is how many realms? It's one realm, okay? We can hear voices if we choose to, but it all depends on which door we go through. When we teach on the prophetic, we teach about going through the right door, hearing the voice of God, or going through the wrong door into the same spirit realm and hearing the voice of the enemy. So when Jesus says, I'm the door and the gate, that's the only gate that we can go through to be able to hear his voice. In a world that we live in, we are so literal. Everything that we think about is literal. And we forget that God is a spirit. In John 4, it says, God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And when we commune with God through the spirit, that is the medium for which we can hear him. But we get so caught up in this world that even the very things we hear in church, you know, like you hear people sometimes in this church will say, I heard God say this and I heard God say that. And some of you jump on your fact checker right away. Is that true? Like, is that really what God? No, we don't need the world to tell us what is true or not. We need to hear the voice of the shepherd, and we need to tune our ears, and we need to listen intently, because he's wanting to speak to us. I want to, I was in Scotland many years ago. I've been to Scotland a few times, and I was speaking in Glasgow, and during my free time, somebody took me up to the Highlands. I don't know if you've ever been to the Highlands in Scotland. You go up to Loch Lomond, That's how they say it. And we were just, you know, going around and visiting the Highlands. And I saw the Highland coos, which are the cows with the curly hair that hides their eyes. And you see the shepherds of the sheep. And it is known in Scotland that these shepherds, these big, strapping, burly men, shepherd, they tend sheep. And they name all their sheep. All the sheep have names. Imagine that. And when the shepherd calls to one of the sheep, let's say his name is Hamish, good Scottish name, right? Scottish people, right? Hamish, come here. Well, I can't even say it in a Scottish accent, but Hamish, come here. The sheep comes running. And the sheep knows the shepherd so intimately. And think about this, right? If a human being could name a sheep, and that sheep knows the voice of the shepherd and knows his name, how much more does our Heavenly Father, who knows our name, he knows us by name, wants to call us to him. And when he calls our name and he calls our voices, we need to go running as well into the arms of our Father. Yeah? Well, you know what? I just want to take a moment and say, if you've ever judged grown men, big, burly grown men wearing a skirt, I mean a kilt, this would be a good time to ask God for forgiveness and repent for that. The way that we hear, that the voices that we hear are three voices. Number one voice, and I say number one, is God. God's voice. The second voice that we hear is the voice of Satan. And he's always competing against God to try and get our attention. And the third voice that we hear is our own voice. So how do we differentiate and how can we tell which is and which isn't? We're going to talk about that in a little bit. But I want to talk first about how we can hear from God. Here's the thing, guys. It's like any relationship. From the time we get saved, we get the Holy Spirit. And we get the ability to commune with God. But if we don't take the time and start to build intimacy with him, and I know intimacy is a word that sometimes makes us really uncomfortable because, you know, it's like giving people access to you. Well, here's the good thing, guys. Truth is the highest quality of intimacy. God already knows the whole truth about us. So whatever we can say to him, whatever he can say to us, we're in a safe place. He loves us anyway. Come on, tell somebody, he loves me anyway. And like in any relationship, we need to start to build that intimacy. When you want to be intimate with someone, what do? You want to get away in a quiet place. You want to go in a private space where you could look into their faces or their eyes. And I'm not just talking about between men and women. If you have a great friendship, you know, you want to get away with that person and spend time with them and build a friendship. And in the same way, we need to do that with Jesus because his heart is just so soft towards us and he wants to say so many things. Let's start to work on our intimacy. Let's start to build that place where as we get closer to him, as we get to know his heart, as we get to start to know that we are safe, that we know that he has a destiny for us, that we know who we are in Christ, that we will hear him better and better because it's a matter of practice. The more we practice, the more time we spend with him, the closer we get to him, the more we hear, the clearer we hear, and we're able to expand that into different ways. God is not a stranger to us. He says, I'm the good shepherd. I'm not a stranger. There's something about knowing that you're owned by someone. I know about you guys, but there's a beautiful feeling of knowing, my goodness, I belong to somebody. Doesn't that feel good? Yeah, I belong to someone. I belong to someone who not only loves me, but he wants to share his heart on a regular basis. And so we need to start to cultivate that spirit of intimacy with God. In Song of Songs, chapter 2, the beloved, the maid, you know, she's looking for her beloved and she couldn't find him. And then all of a sudden she hears his voice and she says, and when you see an exclamation mark at the end of a sentence, you know it means something. There's emphasis on that. And she says, the voice of my beloved. Jesus is our beloved. We are the bride of Christ. And one day, God is going to present us to him and say, here you are, Jesus, this is your bride. So even now, when we hear the sound of our beloved, there's something that needs to happen in our hearts that we want to love him and we want to prepare ourselves because he's coming soon and we want to be presented to him clean and blameless and spotless. Nobody gets excited about that. The joy, there's a joy that starts to build up in our hearts when we hear the sound of the Lord. Can I just say that joy is of the spirit, happiness is of the soul. So even though somebody might be processing their pain with you in a moment, does not mean that they're not carrying residual joy in their hearts. And by the same token, if somebody is happy and making jokes and you know, and having a good time, it does not mean that they're carrying that joy inside of them. Joy comes from the spirit and your connection with God. The voice of God is supposed to bring us such incredible comfort. In Hosea 2:14, it says, therefore, I'm going to allure her. I will lead her into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. That's a beautiful picture, isn't it? Imagine God taking you off and say, here, I want to speak to you and take you off somewhere. And he's speaking gently and tenderly. Well, let me just say that as we grow in hearing from God, the conversations are not always gentle and tender, okay? They start to get, the dialogue starts to get a little bit different. And for me, sometimes I feel like I'm talking to God. It's more like a debate than hearing from him. Recently, I'm having conversation with him, doing a little lamenting. You know, nobody here laments to God, right? Lamenting to him and telling him about my life, and he's speaking to me. And all of a sudden, he says to me, I said, Lord, I really need an answer. And he goes, soon. Okay, you know how each person has a word? My word is seriously. And I'm like, seriously, God, soon? Is that even an answer? The Bible says that 1,000 days is like a day with you, and a day is like 1,000 years. What exactly does soon mean? You know, it's just really funny that I, you know, and I'm having this conversation with him, but God wants to get intimate with us in that place of truth, in that place of being able to speak to us. So how do we hear from him? Well, some people actually hear the audible voice of God. But while we're learning and getting used to hearing from God, there's certain ways that he speaks to us and we can take note of it so we know that it's him. One of the ways that God can speak to us is through pictures. Have you ever seen a picture and all of a sudden you get this message and it speaks volumes to you? And sometimes he will even have some of you creative people draw a picture. I don't know if we got creatives among us, but you're drawing a picture and all of a sudden you hear something in your spirit and you know through that picture, God is speaking to you. Another way that we can hear from God is through impressions. You know that you'll be in a situation and all of a sudden you just get this impression in your heart. Oh, I think God is saying something there. I think God is speaking to me through that. And you would, you know, by the way, every time God speaks to you is not to share. There are times to share. He will tell you when to share. But when you get an impression, and sometimes it's a gentle impression, sometimes it's an impression of urgency, and the Holy Spirit will tell you in the moment, it's time to share that and go tell somebody about it. Another way that we can hear from God is when we journal. You just write, you journal, and you listen to God, and you write it down. Because you see, when we hear beautiful things about ourselves. Imagine that. You know, like it's a love letter, right? When you hear something beautiful, you want to write it down. You want to retain it. You want to remember it. You want to go back and read it and reread it. That's why we journal, because we want to hear what our Father is saying about us, and we put it down in writing so we can go back and rewrite it. But the key is the intimacy that we need to build with God. And sadly, you know, intimacy is sometimes difficult for people. There's some conditions that people experience. A certain subset of our society do suffer from something called intimacy anorexia. Don't go Googling it right now. Trust me on this. It's a thing. It actually exists. And some people, for a particular reason, are not able to cultivate intimacy. They can't connect with people emotionally. They're emotionally unavailable. They just can't get there. And some people get this way through trauma and PTSD and addictions, because addictions affect the neurons in our brains, the receptors, so that we don't connect and we don't build relationship and we don't know how to love and we don't know how to care for people. And these people cannot intimately connect with human beings. But I have to tell you today that the voice of the Lord is able to break through all intimacy anorexia, bring healing to people, and bring them into a place of intimacy like they have never experienced before. There's another situation that, at the end of the first meeting, I had a gentleman walk up to me and say, I've been struggling with this condition, and I've had several surgeries for it. Can you please pray for me? Some people suffer from something called tinnitus. You know, some of you say tinnitus, I don't know, you're fancy, you say tinnitus. If you're not, you say tinnitus. If you're North American, you say tinnitus. Anyway, tinnitus is this constant ringing or buzzing sound in your ear that 24/7 you cannot hear properly because there's buzzing and constant movement in your ear. And some people actually need a noise machine, so they put music on in the background so that they can actually hear. Isn't that a conundrum? Like, you need to put background noise so that you will not hear the noise that's in your ear, and they're not able to hear until they put that background noise in. The problem is that tinnitus is not a condition of the ears. It's actually a condition of the brain. The brain is signaling the human to say, there's something not right neurologically or in my brain, in your brain. So you need to go and have it looked at. And so many doctors will send you to get your ears checked, but it has nothing to do with the ears. And in the same way, us not getting intimate with God is not a condition of hearing from God. Us not being able to hear from God is not a condition of hearing. It's a condition of our hearts. We need to bring our hearts before God and say, I've got this trauma, I've got this pain, I've got this wounding. Heal me, God, so that I can hear you. And just like the people who suffer from tinnitus that have to put background music on to be able to hear, we need to do that sometimes to cultivate the intimacy. We put worship music on in the background. It blocks out all of those voices that are competing for our attention, and it helps us to focus on God, and we're able to sit there and listen to what he's saying, and then we can write it down. So many people I know have been spontaneously healed when they're listening to music. Worship music, or sometimes we call it soaking. Some of you know what soaking is. You put music on, you get yourself in the presence of God, and you start to listen to what he's saying. And people have gotten spontaneously healed. There's such benefit in hearing from God. And I don't know if you've been in the Word this week, but one of the most effective ways for hearing from God is through the Word. I've had people say to me, oh, I don't need the Word. I've got the Holy Spirit. I hear from God directly. Here's the thing. We need the Spirit and we need the Word. We need both of them because they're both from God. And the Word will usually, mostly, all the time, confirm what God is saying. Did you hear that? Usually, mostly, all the time will confirm what the Lord is saying. When you read the Word of God and he speaks to you through it, you will know that you're being affirmed, you're being strengthened, you're comforted, you're reassured, and sometimes God will convict us. And if he convicts you through his Word, and that bears witness with what you already heard from God, what you do is you repent quickly, because God wants to draw us all back in that place where we'll hear him. A good benchmark for whether you're hearing from God or whether you're hearing from the enemy is if the word you're hearing in your ear or in your heart is not synonymous with the nature of God, because God is good. Come on, God is good? All the time? God is good, absolutely. Well, if the words are not consistent with what you see in the Bible, which is our comparison to know it's the voice of God, you know that you're not hearing from him. As we grow and we mature, and come into that place with God, He will speak to us more and more. One of the ways, and one of the reasons that God speaks to us is for others as well. We've had a prophetic ministry here for many years. We've ministered to thousands of people prophetically. We are just on a short break right now, and we'll come back in the new year. But the purpose of the prophetic is to confirm what God has already spoken into your heart. And sometimes we take that word, and we don't get the microwave effect. We don't get, right, the instant answer. So we come back a month later and say, I want a new word because God didn't fulfill that word. Can I tell you, I'm waiting for a word for 20 years and I haven't seen it fulfilled. But we need to patiently wait before the Lord. And what we do in the meantime is we pour into others. Because the purpose of us being followers of Jesus is to serve others and to empower others and to teach others. So if you don't get an answer right away, please don't come back for a prophetic word a month later. Give it a good few months at least. And then come back, because God is wanting to make us, He wants to make us contributors, not just consumers. Would that be okay? Yeah, good. Another reason that God speaks to us is for others. Another way He speaks to us is to help people come into deliverance and freedom. Yes, we just had some freedom ministry take place in between the meetings. I'm just going to tell you a quick story. We had some freedom ministry a month ago, and I'm praying over this young girl, and as I finished praying freedom off of her, the Lord says, I want to prophesy. And I started to prophesy over her, and I looked at her and I said, I see God opening a door for you. He's going to take you into a place where you are going to have, you are going to work in this job, but it'll be a stepping stone, because the ultimate place God is going to take you is dress designing school. And her eyes bug out and she starts to weep and starts crying. And I said, and God says that you're going to go to designer school, you're going to design beautiful things, and your name will be known among this industry. And she just started crying and saying, yes, I've always wanted to go to designer school. Another guy, I was just sharing this story quickly. About 3 weeks ago, this man approached me at the end of the meeting, and he says, Lillian, I want to tell you a story. And I said, what is it? And he says, you don't know me. But he says, about a year and a half ago, you were hosting the meeting, and you had a picture of this man sitting at his breakfast table with a magazine. And he had a magazine with a red sports car, and he's having his breakfast, and he carries the magazine around with him, and he's staring at the picture day in and day out. And he says, And you said that the man needed to stop doing that because he was making that his idol. And he says, you don't know it, but that I was the man. I was the same sports car. I was looking at it, and I was making it my idol. And he says, the minute that you released that word, I stopped. And he says, I got completely delivered from the idol worship of that car. So God speaks to us for others to bring them out of darkness into light. And one quick thing before we finish. Does God only speak to Christians or believers? No? No, He doesn't. Well, in John chapter 10, He says, there are others that I need to bring into the kingdom. There are others. God says that Jesus, the good shepherd, will lead the 99 sheep and go after the one. He will go to whomever, because He wants to draw them in by His love, and He wants to speak to them. He wants to also hear their hearts. I was traveling a couple of weeks ago. I was in a country area going through, some dark roads, country roads. You know how they are. Anyway, all of a sudden, I come up on this sign, Damascus. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I'm on the road to Damascus. I hope I come out with my eyesight intact. And, you know, but I would have loved an encounter with Jesus, can I say? Who wouldn't love one of those, eh? Come on, yeah. Anyway, and I remember Saul. Saul was a persecutor of Christians, and he was on his way to Damascus. He was on the road. He was going to go find Christians and bring them back and feed them to lions. And he has this encounter with Jesus, and he doesn't know who Jesus is, never met him. Oh, I don't know if he never met him, but I don't believe he ever met him. Anyway, all of a sudden, he hears a voice. Why, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he falls on his feet. Short and long of the story, he's blind when he falls on his feet. By the way, there's no horse in Acts chapter 9. He didn't fall off a horse. He was on his feet. And then Ananias comes and prays for him. He regains his sight. And he becomes one of the greatest apostles, if not the greatest apostle that ever lived. So God will speak to anybody and everybody. Are we positioned to hear from Him? Do we want to hear? So let's look for those pictures. Let's look for the impressions. Let's wait for the impressions. And let us position ourselves in that place to build intimacy with Jesus. If you have, you know, if you struggle with intimacy in the natural, I just want to say that Jesus is gentle and he's kind. If you have had hurt or pain in your life that has caused you to step back and say, I'm not going to trust anybody anymore. If I can't, I can't trust. I don't know if I can trust as God. He's the good shepherd. And today, he wants to draw your heart in. He wants to build intimacy. He wants to look into your eyes. There's something so beautiful about looking into each other's eyes. Jesus wants to look in your eye and draw you into this place. I want to say a quick word while I was preparing this message. And Jesus is speaking to me and he says, Lillian, I'm a good shepherd. He says, I'm a good shepherd. And he says, hearing my voice is a benefit of the kingdom. It's a gift from heaven to be able to hear my voice. He says, I have sons and daughters who used to hear my voice, but the other voices have overtaken them. They have allowed other voices to intrude into that beautiful, intimate space where they once heard my voice. And it feels like they have squandered the gift like the prodigal son. And they have found themselves in this dry place, almost like, it's in the Bible, it's almost like in a pigsty. When the prodigal son came to his senses, he returned home to the father. And the Lord was ministering to me and he says, I have sons and daughters that are there right now and I want to draw them back into my heart. I want to bring them back into that, in the bridegroom's chamber and speak kindly to them and to restore the broken parts that led them there in the first place. So I want to say, if that's you and you felt like you have gone into a place where you can't hear from God because the pain was just too much, and you had to shut it all down. And in shutting it down, you shut down Jesus. Today, he wants to meet you. And guys, we have had a wonderful, wonderful prophetic word from Lindley Allen about the river here and about the well that's being filled up. We've had several words about oil in the well. And one of the ways that Jesus can help us to hear is to put oil in your ears so that it cleanses all the parasites and takes out all the junk, and he's able to help us to hear from him. I want to invite you this morning, whether you're hearing from God and you want to go a little bit higher and get a little bit mature, or you've put it on the back burner, or you've never heard from him, I want to invite you into this well this morning. There's a well here at Atwell. And there's a river that's flowing here. And I want to invite you to come. You know, it's very vulnerable for us sometimes to say, you know, I'm in that place. And I can tell you my story. I've been in that place. And I'm like, God, I can't hear you right now. But today, we have an opportunity to come jump in the river and build intimacy with God. Because when we come into that river, we will find him. We'll find his beautiful arms wrapped around us. We will hear his soft voice and we'll feel his presence. So today, wherever you are, I want to invite you. Come on. Come up here. Just come, bow, do whatever you want to do. Kneel and say, God, I must hear more from you. And I'm giving up the competition for my ears these days. I'm giving up the competition in exchange for the voice of my good shepherd. So I say, come on, let's jump in the river and start to build intimacy with him. Jesus, we bless you. We thank you that you're the good shepherd. God, I ask for all those that are coming here, God, those that are desiring more of you, and those, oh Lord God, that have put it on the back burner and said, I can't listen anymore because I don't know which is which. Today, good shepherd, will you speak? Will you minister to your sons and daughter? And for those that are passionate for another impartation, those that are passionate, oh Lord God, to see the river flow, to bring, oh Lord God, as you bring in the next revival and as you bring in, God, the harvest, will you empower your children today? And may you reach deep into their hearts and bless them, God, to find you and know that their hearts are safe with you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
amazing. Thank you, Lillian. You know, hearing the Lord's voice and being led by the Spirit is so important. So Holy Spirit, may you open up our eyes, open up our ears, open up our senses, open up the realm of the Spirit for each one of us. And I ask for an increase. Ministry team, if you would, just begin to pray and just bless. But right here, the Lord's wanting to just release what we're asking for, because he's a good dad. So bless us as a community to hear his voice more deeply. I bless your intimacy in the spirit realm. I bless you every time you open up the word of God, that you would hear his voice. Bless you as you're talking to friends or to colleagues or at work, that you would receive revelation and wisdom from him, that he would speak to you very clearly and release life to you. Bless you. Well, thank you everybody for coming. We're gonna just keep ministering here. You can stay here for as long as you need in terms of receiving. People will come and pray. But thank you for being here. If you have any questions, you need any information, or you want to sign up to a Connect group or join a team, we've got our team through the glass doors in the Welcome Center. They would love to connect with you. We would love to connect with you and help you just get plugged in. Enjoy the week. May you experience more of God and experience more of his presence and his love and his voice, deeper intimacy. Have a great week. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your generosity, contributions. Have a good week. Let's go for it, ministry team.